Trusses are efficient form of structures that can span short to very long distances. Use of trusses as roof structures is very common, and in fact most warehouses and chain grocery stores use them. They are also used in many long span bridges. Trusses are light and flexible and are made of triangular panels, which are required to have a stable structure. One reason for trusses to be efficient is because of the large number of openings in their webs, which makes them lighter by reducing material usage and lifting costs. These openings are commonly used for mechanical pipes or electrical conduits. Trusses are made of top and bottom cords that are connected by a series of vertical or diagonal members. Depending on how the cords are arranged, many different types of trusses can be made. Trusses rely on the concept that members work under axial forces and no bending is transferred between the end joints. This will simplify the design and construction process. Textbook examples of truss design are further simplified by assuming that only joints get loaded. While this might be true in some cases, most trusses will be loaded on various locations along their top and bottom cords. Trusses are generally made out of steel or wood, but they can also be made in reinforced concrete or aluminum. Depending on the span size and loads, steel trusses can be made with small double angles or large I-beams. They are generally made in steel fabrication facilities and will get transported to the project site for installation. Long trusses may be made in smaller pieces, which can be bolted or welded together on site. Let me mention a quick fact about steel members under axial forces. Members made out of steel have more capacity in tension compared to compression due to the fact that they can buckle under compressive load. This concept can be demonstrated using a ruler. If I press the ruler from both ends, you will see that it bends easily, but it will not be so easy to stretch the ruler if I pull both ends. So that is why steel truss members under compression will likely have a larger section size. And that is why designers try to have a truss configuration that put more members in tension than compression. So let's talk about the force distribution in trusses. Under downward loads, such as truss self-weight, roof or floor loads, or even snow, truss top cord will be in compression, which means that the member endpoints are pushed towards each other, while the bottom cord goes into tension. The force type in cords varies based on the configuration. And with minor changes in the web cords, we can get a different load distribution. Like beams, trusses are designed for strength and deflection, and an increase in their total depth will result in a reduction in force and deflection, but the depth may be limited by headroom and other architectural requirements. There are many computer tools to design trusses. User can model the truss and apply various types of loads and get the deflection and design results quickly. It is good to mention that there is one special type of truss called virendial, which uses moment-resisting joints without any diagonal members. These trusses do not need to have the triangular form since they have joints with moment capacity, which provide stability.